to all my friends at the fountains. We continue with our virtual lectures. This week is going to be something really special. I'm very excited about it, where we'll actually be showing you Pirates of Penzance on Wednesday and Friday. We'll have the two acts, Act 1 on Wednesday, Act 2 on Friday. So anyway, welcome. I'm Marguerite Mullee, and I'm here. You notice my hair is getting longer and longer. I have not had a haircut since we started this whole quarantine. My husband and I are just about at phase one of reopening. So let's get to Pirates of Penzance. Today is going to be the lecture about it. We're going to be listening to some excerpts from the really wonderful, wonderful music. Now, as most of you know, Pirates of Penzance, also known as The Slave of Duty, is a comic opera, music by Arthur Sullivan, and the libretto by William Schwenk Gilbert. He went as W.S. Gilbert. It was their fifth collaboration. It's one of the most frequently performed Gilbert and Sullivan operas. The Pirates of Penzance was the only Gilbert and Sullivan opera to have its official premiere here in the United States, as opposed to England. At the time, American law didn't provide copyright protection to foreigners, so their earlier opera, HMS Pinafore from 1878, had been very, very successful in London. So, of course, you had people then in America doing their own productions of it. They took liberties with the text, and they paid absolutely no royalties to the creators. So Gilbert and Sullivan hoped to prevent this further copyright piracy for their next opera by delaying publication of the score and the libretto, but even more importantly, presenting the first production of the opera in America before people could copy it. By opening the Pirates of Penzance themselves on Broadway before the London production, they were able to keep the profits, and the production was protected under American copyright law. They were also in charge of the U.S. touring companies, and that brought in even more profit. Now, about the subject matter. Fiction and plays about pirates were very, very popular in the 19th century. The image of the romanticized, dashing pirate, as well as the idea of repentant pirates, had captured the imagination of the public. The Pirates of Penzance goes a bit beyond this, and with the wonderfully loopy logic of Gilbert and Sullivan, treats stealing as a professional career path with apprentices and standard tools of the trade. While the HMS Pinafore was enjoying a very successful run in London, Gilbert began working on the libretto for Pirates in December of 1878. Once Pinafore became a hit in London, Gilbert and Sullivan had the financial resources to produce future shows themselves and free themselves from having to use any type of financial backers. Almost a year later, in November of 1879, Gilbert and Sullivan sailed to America with a company of strong singers to play both Pinafore and Pirates of Penzance in New York. These actors were talented, but they were not well-known stars, so they didn't get the high fees that the well-known people would command. Sullivan wrote the music to match the particular talents of each singer. Gilbert acted as stage director, and Sullivan conducted the music rehearsals. In December of 1879, Sullivan wrote a letter to his mother about the new opera. Quote, "I think it will be a great success, for it is exquisitely funny, and the music is strikingly tuneful and catching." Even the title, Pirates of Penzance, is a multi-layered joke. First of all, in 1879, Penzance was a very calm and a rather boring seaside, not the place where one would expect to encounter pirates or even have any type of excitement whatsoever. Also, the title was a jab at the theatrical pirates who had staged unlicensed performances of the HMS Pinafore in America. Pirates opened on December 31st in 1879 in New York, was an immediate hit. On the 2nd of January, Sullivan wrote in another letter to his mom, "The libretto is ingenious, clever, wonderfully funny in parts, sometimes brilliant in dialogue, beautifully written for music, as is all Gilbert does. The music is infinitely superior in every way to the Pinafore, tunier and more developed, of a higher class altogether. I think that in time it will be very popular." Its London debut was a few months later, April 3rd, 1880. It ran for 363 performances. So now, let's get to the plot and the music. So Act One, we're off the coast of Cornwall. It's during Queen Victoria's reign, and Frederick celebrates the completion of his 21st year and the end of his apprenticeship to a gentlemanly band of pirates. The pirate's maid, Ruth, appears and reveals that she kind of has this awkward secret. As Frederick's nursemaid, long ago, she made a bit of a mistake. She didn't quite hear Frederick's father's instructions to apprentice him to a ship's pilot. Instead, she apprenticed him to a pirate. So we'll hear that now. Decided that once he served his 21 years, he would stop being a pirate, that he could just not do this anymore, and he's going to leave them. Now, Frederick has never seen any woman other than Ruth, his nursemaid, and he believes her to be beautiful. And the pirates know better, and they suggest that Frederick take Ruth with him when he returns to civilization. But now, Frederick announces that although it pains him, so strong is his sense of duty that once free from his apprenticeship, he'll be forced to devote himself to the pirates' destruction. He also points out that they're not very successful pirates, since they are all orphans. They allow their people to go free if they too are orphans. So Frederick notes the word of this has gone around. So if there are any captured ships, the companies say, well, we're orphans. And then, of course, the pirates free them because they're so soft-hearted. Frederick invites the pirates to give up piracy and go with him so that he need not destroy them. But the pirate king says that, contrasted with respectability, piracy is comparatively honest.
I shall live and die a pirate king.
Leave Frederick and Ruth on shore. Frederick sees a group of beautiful young girls approaching the pirate lair and realizes Ruth misled him about her appearance. He sends Ruth away, he's very upset, and then he hides. The girls arrive, Frederick reveals himself, and the girls are quite frightened and very frantic. He begs them to help him reform. The girls are fascinated by him. He is kind of cute, but they all reject him, except one, Mabel. She responds to his plea, scolding her sisters for their lack of charity, and she offers Frederick her pity. And now we're going to hear Poor Wandering One. The coloratura on this is just wonderful. Wonderful writing, wonderful singing.
Thank you.
really quite a wonderful song. All right, so they fall in love. And the other girls are kind of discussing whether they should be eavesdropping or leave the new couple alone. They decide to talk about the weather, but all while they're looking at the couple and seeing what's going on. Frederick warns the young ladies that the pirates are soon going to return. But before they can flee, the pirates arrive and capture the girls intending to marry them.
Stay, we must not lose our senses. Men who stick at no offenses will unharmed be here. Piracy, the dreadful trade is. Pray you get you hence, young ladies, while the coast is clear.
No, we must not lose our senses. If we stick at no offenses, we should not be here. Piracy, the dreadful trade is. Nice companions for young ladies. Let us
is a major general, and in fact he soon arrives and introduces himself. Now it's interesting, the character of Major General Stanley was believed to be a caricature of a real general, Sir Garnet Wolseley. And according to his biographer, Wolseley took no offense at the caricature, and sometimes even sang, "I am the very model of a modern major general," in private for his family and friends.
I am the very model of a modern major general. I've been the flesh and vegetable animal and mineral. I know the kings of England and I call the fight historical. The manners of Sir Waterloo in order categorical. I'm very well acquainted to with matters mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and the practical. About my noble theorem, I'm teeming with a lot of news. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. I'm very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and immaculous. In short, it matters very noble and upon the middle. I am the very model of a modern major general. I know mythic history, king authors and sacanodons. I utter hard of cross encyclopedic taste for paradox. I cut in every giant all the crimes of hearing apparatus. In conics, I absorb peculiarities and parabolas. I can tell an argument of Raphael's from Gerard's and Sophonies. I know the croaking chorus from the frogs of Aristophanes. Then I can arm a fugue of which I've heard the music dinner for. And whistle all the airs from that inferno of the pinafore. Then I can write a washing bidding Babylonic cuneiform and tell you every detail and character is a uniform. In short, it matters vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern major general.
Okay, you get the idea. This does go on for a bit. All right, so he finishes his song, and by the way, it gets faster as it goes along. He begs the pirates not to take his daughters, who's going to take care of him in his old age. Having heard that they are the famous Pirates of Penzance, he pretends to be an orphan, the secret weapon. So the soft-hearted pirates release the girls, And they make the Major General and his daughters honorary members of their band. Pirates were singing, "Here's a first-rate opportunity to be married with impunity," and now they're singing, "Pray observe the magnanimity." So, that's the end of Act 1. Now Act 2. Major General is sitting alone in a ruined chapel on his estate, surrounded by his daughters. His conscience is tortured by the lie that he told the pirates, and the girls try to console him. The sergeant, his squad of police, arrive to announce that they're ready to arrest the pirates.
Thank you.
Then you had the gals singing two different melodies, and then they were all put together singing at the same time. So the policemen are trying very hard to be brave. The women are singing, you know, you are so wonderful, even though you're definitely going to be slaughtered and we're never going to see you again and you're never going to come back. So that's the dynamic that's going on here. All right, so police are obviously nervous at the end of all this, but they still leave to fulfill their mission and their destiny. So left alone, there's Frederick, and he reflects on his opportunity to atone for a life of piracy, and is interrupted by the appearance of the Pirate King and Ruth.
Now for the pirate's lair, oh joy abound, oh sweet relief, oh rapture and example, at last I may atone in some slight measure for the repeated acts of theft and pillage, of which, in a sense of duty, stand dictation. I, circumstance's victim, have been guilty. Young Frederick, who calls your late commander.
And I, your little Ruth.
Oh, mad intruders, how dare ye face me? And resentment, and so I will be merciful. Say on.
All right, so now comes a very, very interesting song. Ruth and the Pirate King have realized that they found a loophole in Frederick's apprenticeship contract. Since his birthday is the 29th of February, which is a leap year, technically he has only had 5 birthdays, and he will not reach his 21st birthday until he is in his 80s, sometime in 1940. So here is now the Pirate King and Ruth telling him about the paradox.
When you had left our pirate fall, we tried to raise our spirits then to call them to our custom hold with whip and quibble quaint. But all in vain the whips we heard, we lay or sobbed upon the rocks, until to somebody occurred a startling paradox. A most ingenious paradox, with quips and quibbles heard in flocks, but none to beat this paradox.
I shouldn't be surprised if we're going to the agency of an ill-natured fairy.
You are the victim of this clumsy arrangement, having been born in leap year on the 29th of February. And so, by a simple arithmetical process, you'll easily discover that though you've lived 21 years, yet if we go by birthdays, you're only 5 and a little bit over.
And she gaily mocks, though counting in the usual way is 21 I've been alive. Yet reckoning by my natal day, yet reckoning by my natal day, I am a little boy of 5.
Frederick agrees to rejoin the pirates because he has to do his duty. It's the honorable thing to do. And following this is this incredibly wild patter song that I'm going to play now. And the only way I figured out what the words say is to actually see subtitles on it, because it's just remarkable that human beings can even sing this song. So this is called It Doesn't Really Matter.
And at any price, I will do my duty.
Oh, bravely spoken.
Come! You're one of us once more. Lead on, I follow.
Come, back to the ship, brought back door.
My eyes are fully open to my awful situation. I should go up once for Mabel and will make her an oration. I would tell her I am bad by duty and my moral senses, and I don't know what to do about the pending consequences. Now I do not want to perish by the sword or by the dagger, but a pirate mustn't dodge a little part in a noble swagger, and a word or two of compliment my vanity with clatter, but I've got to go tonight, and so it really doesn't matter.
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 If this were not a little matter, generally sitting, I should give you my advice upon the subject willy-nilly. I should show you in a moment how to grapple with the question, and you'd really be astonished at the force of my suggestion. On the subject, I shall write you one most valuable letter full of excellent suggestion when I feel a little better. But at present, I'm afraid I am as bad as any hat. So I'll sing this song for Ruddy Gore. It really doesn't matter.
What we sing just 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 doesn't matter.
No, it really doesn't matter. What we sing just doesn't matter.
Matter, 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 matter. If I had been so lucky as to have a steady mother who could talk to me as we are talking now to one another, who could give me good advice, she discovered I was earning, which is just the very favor which I knew I am conferring. My existence would have made a rather interesting little, and I might have never been very decent into all this, particularly rapid and intelligible patter isn't generally heard. And if it is, it doesn't matter.
If it is, it doesn't matter.
If it is, it doesn't matter.
If it is,
this particularly rapid and intelligible patter isn't generally heard. And if it is, it doesn't matter. This particularly rapid and intelligible patter isn't generally heard. And if it is, it doesn't matter. Matter, 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 matter.
That is so much fun. That's so great. All right, so, again, Frederick being Frederick, he sees it as his duty to inform the pirate king that the major general lied to him, that he really is not an orphan. The pirate king is furious and declares that the pirate's revenge will be swift and terrible.
Yes, tonight the traitor dies. perish. Tonight he dashes away, tomorrow his ghost like bicycle butter in sorrow. Though once was not in the nature they cherish, and all who pass to an easy shall perish. Away, 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 away.
Pleads with him to stay, but he feels bound by his duty to the pirates. They agree to be faithful to each other until he is released. It'll be sometime in like 1940. He's going to be in his 80s. Although Mabel does admit that does seem a bit long. Frederick leaves, and Mabel steals herself, tells the police that they must go alone without Frederick to face the pirates. Now, the police are a very thoughtful bunch. They muse that an outlaw might be just like any other man, and it's a shame to deprive him, quote, of that liberty that is so dear to us all.
When a felon's not engaged in his employment,
his employment,
or maturing his felonious little plans,
his plans,
his capacity for innocent enjoyment,
self-enjoyment,
is just as great as any honest man.
Honest man,
our feelings we with difficulty smother,
when
constabulary duties to be done,
to be done.
But take one consideration with another,
with another.
Lot is not a happy one.
Oh, when constabulary duties to be done, to be done, a policeman's lot is not a happy one. Woo!
And here is always a good, wonderful example of interesting choreography, so you will be seeing that when we watch the movie. Okay, the police then hear the pirates coming to avenge themselves of the Major General's lie, and they all hide. So in this example, they're going to be singing a rollicking band of pirates, we, and with cat-like tread. But you're also going to hear a reworking of the Anvil song from Verdi's Il Trovatore opera. You'll recognize it. They're tiptoeing now.
Quiet!
Silence, dread, a cautious ray we feel. No sound at all, we never speak a word. A fly's foot, all we be distinctly heard.
Ta-la-ta-la.
So stealthily the pirate creeps while all the household soundly sleeps.
Your silent matters for dark lead to the sea. Take your file and your skeletonic keys.
Cat-like tread upon the rainy sea. Silence, dread.
does go on for a while too, and you hear the policemen singing their tarantara, and the pirates singing their music. All right, this all goes on. There's a light then turned on in the house. They realize the Major General is coming out, and the pirates hide. Major General Stanley appears. He's sleepless with guilt. And the Major General listens to the soothing breeze. His daughters then come out looking for him.
Now what is this and what is that? And why does father leave his rest at such a time of night? Is this so very incompletely dressed? Your father is and always was the most methodical of men. It isn't very affable to go to bed at 10:30. What strange occurrence can it be that calls your father from his rest at such a time of night? Is this so very incompletely dressed?
Summon your men and effect their capture.
Frederick, save us!
The elder were naval, I would if I could, but I am not able.
He's telling the truth, he is not able.
All right, so we've heard the pirates have attacked, the police rush to the defense, but the police are easily defeated. The Pirate King tells the captured Major General to prepare for death. But the police sergeant has one more strategy. He demands that the pirates yield in Queen Victoria's name. And the pirates, overcome with loyalty to their queen, do so. Ruth then appears, reveals that the pirates are all noblemen who have gone wrong. The Major General is very impressed by this, and all is forgiven. Frederick and Mabel are reunited, and the Major General is happy to marry all his daughters to the noble pirates after all. So, I will be seeing you again on Wednesday with Act One of Pirates of Penzance. Thank you so much for spending time with me this afternoon, and have a very healthy week. Thank you.